So the background of this, if I can be just a tad egoic, I'm a professional futurist whose my special has been intuition. And recently, in the last year or so, I've been a big science fiction buff. The Journal of Future Studies wanted to do a special issue on the intersection of science fiction and studies of the future. Well, I had to write about Olaf Stapledon, who's one of the big champions of that. And when I got done writing about his work, I was just struck by the fact that he had to be influenced by extraterrestrial sources, interdimensional sources, in order to do that. But it was nothing in the literature about that, and because he was an avowed agnostic, didn't believe in survival of physical life, clearly he wouldn't have believed that. So at any rate, there's a process attributed to the Russian MD Rakoff, who's a hypnotist MD. The Rakoff process is sometimes called artificial reincarnation, where you put yourself in trance and then you connect to a discarnate being and get information. So I did that with Stapledon, got him, yep, he agreed. When he was alive, he didn't know he was influenced, but he was, in fact, and he's available, as well as others where he is, to give information to people of us for our well-being.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to walk through a presentation, a PowerPoint presentation that I've developed to encourage and introduce this project. All right. And then we'll do some questions and answers, and we'll see if we can't make some interesting events happen here that will be, I think, effective in bringing Edgar's preferences into life. Can you see this? All right, so this is the project we're talking about, and it developed out of the work of one person, Helane Wabe.
Thank you and welcome. I'm really excited to be here today sharing with you about this topic, the science of channeling. First, we'd like to thank our funders of some projects we've already done in this area. Couldn't do this work without them. So first, I'd like to share with you a little bit about my background. I'm a naturopathic physician, and I've been in private practice for a number of years and have been focused on mind-body medicine. I'm also a meditation teacher and have been teaching meditation for over a decade. I have a master's in clinical research, and I ran numerous clinical studies for over a decade before coming to IONS. In that decade, I worked with combat veterans with PTSD, stressed older adults, and dementia caregivers. I got a grant from the National Institute of Health on how mindfulness meditation works. In the lab, I've stressed people, I've relaxed people, I've collected measures like pupil dilation, blood pressure, brain waves, heart waves, skin conductance. I've collected saliva, blood, and urine. I've been on governmental grant panels and institutional review boards. I've written numerous papers and presented at conferences internationally. So why am I telling you all this? Besides, of course, to establish my credibility as a scientist. Well, nowhere in my academic background is there anything about channeling. So how did I end up standing here today to promote a channeling research program? What's the connection? Well, what you wouldn't know from looking at me is that I come from a long line of channels. I actually went to my first seance when I was 10 years old at my grandparents' house. You also wouldn't know that every single member of my mother's family has channeling ability, from my grandmother, who surprised everybody by going into a full trance at 15 years old, to my uncle, who was tested for psychokinetic skills at John F. Kennedy University and channeled a book through automatic writing, to my mom, who you'll get to experience today. Well, through many synchronistic events, I'm now at IONS with the freedom to use my research skills to explore important research questions about channeling. I'm incredibly excited and grateful to be here with you today. So channeling's been known for a long time, from the Delphi Oracle in Greece, to Moses, to the Virgin Mary and Muhammad. In fact, many of our world religions were founded on channeled prophecy or messages. Fast forward now to the present. In the Western world, we have well-known figures like Edgar Casey, Esther Hicks, and TV shows like The Long Island Medium and Monica the Medium. So if there's such history and interest, then why hasn't there been more research on it? Maybe because it's taboo, or there are inherent biases towards it, or maybe because it's actually very difficult to study. It's probably a little bit of all of these. Of course, some research has already been done, but many of the studies have been small or used questionable scientific methods. Only recently has there been more rigorous research, but there's a need for a lot more. So what is channeling exactly? I'd like to use this umbrella definition. Channeling is the communication of information to or through a live human from a source other than the physical as we know it. This umbrella term contains words like medium, channel, and psychic. We could actually talk for hours about the differences between these terms and what people think they mean. But for brevity's sake, I'd like to leave that for another time.
Right. So let's talk a little bit about what she's talking about. It's a little easier than just listening, right? So with this project, what Helane is hoping to do is to answer a number of questions. Essentially, she's trying to establish what channeling and mediumship is. We've got a lot of people in the world doing things saying they are channels or mediums, but they aren't all very effective and they aren't all verifiable. So we want to know what really is going on. We want to know how it works in the mind, what is happening in the body and the mind, and how people develop the ability. We're also trying to establish channeling as a valid way to receive and transmit information, and to develop a definitive database of information. That's where I'm going to come in. When Helane talks about it, she said, as she said in the video, she's getting this from a book by Klimo on channeling, the communication of information to or through a physically embodied human being from a source that is said to exist on some other dimension or level of reality. Okay, not from the normal mind or self of the channel. And that's tricky, and that's the essence of what we're going to have to be working on as we go forward with this project. So she has a set of research questions that we're working with. What is the current state of the published research? That's what I'm doing. What is the current state of the unpublished research? And that's part of what she's doing. She's creating a series of gatherings for people who are doing research but haven't yet published. How common is the channeling? We're doing a series of surveys. We've already done one, and I'll give you some results on that, and you're welcome to participate in that. Now she's starting another one with a random sample. Now, the next question then is, as I said, how does it work? What's really going on? Then can we verify the information? And finally, are there defining characteristics of the person who can be acting as a channel? So when we talk about what's on those TV shows and things like that, you know, we see that there appear to be some characteristics that are common to these people, but we don't know for sure. And we don't know if there are qualities that we can begin to identify in a child or in a family or something, or if we have to train people to do these things. The next thing that I'd like to talk about is a little bit who all is involved in my involvement in this project. So we have the Institute of Noetic Sciences. We also have the Gaia Living Systems Institute, and Oliver mentioned. We have Helane, and Helane's working with Dean Radin. Not only directly through your IONS community groups, but also on various videos. Yes, the What the Bleep and so on. Arnaud Delorme is not so well known, but he has developed a freeware EEG interpretive software package and is known all over the world as an EEG specialist and is doing some wonderful things with channels and other folks using EEGs. Of course, then we have Oliver Willis Harmon, who he mentioned, who was the first president of IONS. We'll talk a little bit about him, and then my role in this. So that's what we're going to be looking at today. First, IONS, most of you know this, it was founded by Edgar Mitchell. It's a nonprofit organization dedicated to supporting individual and collective transformation through consciousness research learning. And they do the research, they create tools that help people, and I'm looking forward to being able to help people have tools from what we're doing. And then they have a retreat center in Petaluma and invite a lot of wonderful people to come together. And I just love, this is a new statement of the goal, to create a shift in consciousness worldwide where people recognize we're all part of an interconnected whole and are inspired to take action to help humanity and the planet thrive. That just feels so good. And you'll see why Gaia Living Systems Institute is also interested in consciousness, but in the context of the transformation of the ecology and economy, so they're all working in harmony. And my job is to provide the programs and the resources for the Gaia Living Systems Institute. What you see over here is a handout from one of our programs where we were looking at values, assumptions, and beliefs and their role in ecology, economy, and consciousness. So those are the two institutions that are involved. And now what I'd like to do is talk about some of the people that I'm working with and share with you my story, how I got involved with this. And although he doesn't like to acknowledge it, Oliver is a huge part of that story, just because he is. As you all know, he likes to make things happen. Let's start with Helani. As she said, she's a naturopath. And she practiced in Milwaukee, Oregon, which I thought was fascinating. I never connected with her when she was here in Oregon. But she's in Petaluma now. And she did all those studies at OHSU. She's working at IONS full-time now on this project, which is very exciting. Her one main concern here is how little information there is and what it is and how it works. You know, she grew up in a family where channeling was normal. And now she's has the opportunity to bring her scientific research background into that. I'm going to go back to the main slide here. You can read them. All right. So she says, based on the Klima work, that there are many types of channeling. There's the mental type of channeling. This is what most of us who are aware of channeling. Someone will say, your grandmother's in the room and she's telling me this. But there are also other forms of the mental work, and we're not quite sure what's going on at any given point, you know, and we'd like to be able to make those distinctions. Automism is typically things like automatic writing and Ouija board, or using a pendulum to get information. A full trance channel is someone who actually allows another entity to enter into the body and usually take over the body. And the illustration I like to give people most often for that one is from Shirley MacLaine's movie, Out on a Limb, where you get to watch Kevin Ryerson become a Scottish character, and with his eyes closed, he goes over and pours himself a glass of liquid to drink, some glass of whiskey. It's kind of a fun thing. You get to see how fully someone can embody another entity. And then finally, many, many people experience this, some kind of channeling during sleep and dreams. You know, grandmother visiting was my first experience of that after she had passed on. She showed up in one of my dreams. So as we move forward then, another of the issues, not only do we have many types of the channeling, as Helane, you know, lets us know, we get different kinds of information. I'm getting some scientific and technical information, and there are a number of other people who are doing the same. There's biographical information where people find out In one case, a person found out that he was adopted. He had no idea he was adopted, but he found out through a channel. And then forecasts and predictions. That's fairly common in near-death experiences and sometimes happens in channeling. Healing support. Edgar Cayce is the classic example of that. Channeling support for healing. And then the general guidance about how to maintain or achieve well-being. And I'm sure if you've been tracking any of that stuff online, Archangel Michael or the Arcturians or whoever who are giving us general guidance for our life right now. The source is varied. Normally people are reporting things from deceased human beings, but there are all these other sources. If you're familiar with the Seth material, that would be spirit beings. If you're familiar with the Abraham material, again, that's spirit beings, or could be archetypal energies. They call themselves source energy. It's Esther who calls the collective Abraham. Many people, are saying they're channeling Archangel Michael or Raphael right now. And in the ancient times, people would be channeling Zeus or Nike or, one of the other gods in their world. And one of the things that we're seeing more and more is people are being aware of channeling their higher self. And actually, that's what Edgar Cayce talks about. His book, How to Channel Your Higher Self, says that your higher self and your guardian angel are one and the same. So these various varieties of channels are all part of the issue. We've got these different kinds of people, different kinds of information, different kinds of sources where they're coming from. How do we work with all of this? Initially, we have to go into the literature, but we are also dealing with our own experiences. And as Oliver shared with you, he has been kind of on the edge of this whole kind of experience for some time now. And so one of the things, he gets to come now on my little grid here, and we get to see that he is, as he said, a former colleague of Willis Harmon, and I worked with him then. He's also been the professor of future studies at University of Houston at Clear Lake. Intuitive methods. And you've seen him as in work as that coordinator there. And one of the things that we like is this image that he uses of the manifestation of thought form. I think it's kind of cool because it really does tie in with what we're talking about here. You can exchange, between people, but more often than not, it's shared from this manifest thought form. So he talks about a field of ultimate reality where there is no form, no entity, it's not matter, it's not energy, it's a field. And then that evolves into or shows up in our universe as what we call the zero-point field, what Ernest Laszlo calls the Akashic field, and what many people will call the quantum field. And what Ernest Laszlo is saying is that all events and potential, past, present, and future, is woven into this field that is spread through the universe, and we have access to that. And this is equivalent to, as Markley suggests in this, it is the implicate order. And through a process we don't fully understand yet, it becomes the explicate order and becomes manifest to us in some form, some thought form that then we can pick up on. Some people have a more impenetrable barrier. Others are more able to pick up on it. So that's a little bit of what Oliver has contributed in the way of explanation for what we're doing, as well as the continuing instigation that he does. Our next character in my story is to honor Willis Harmon. This is a photograph of a painting that's on the wall in the IONS offices in Petaluma. I knew him initially through my mother, who worked with him at the Educational Policy Research Center, and then later I worked with him and with Markley at the Center for Study of Social Policy. And his focus has always been on changing consciousness to change the world, ever since he got involved with what he called the Human Potential Movement. He was the president of IONS from 76 to 97, and he passed on in January of 97. And one of the things that I thought he would be interesting to share with you that he has said is that belief systems serve two motives. One is they give us a cognitive framework to interpret new experience. The second is they provide the need to ward off threatening aspects of reality. And then this sentence is marvelous. A person will be open to information insofar as possible, but will unconsciously reject it, screen it out, or alter it insofar as is necessary to ward off threat and anxiety. So when we think about Harman's contribution, we need to be aware that he brought a remarkable understanding. I'm going to open up here. He brought a remarkable understanding from engineering through the human potential movement, through the cultural studies that go along with being a futurist, to the Institute of Noetic Sciences, and was able to create a context for the research that was going on there. What he is asking us to do now is to expand that research and make it available to a wider group of people and make it applicable in a wider range of possible applications. And mostly, he wants us to be able to recognize that the technologies that we have been using are no longer going to be serving us. And I'll share that more with you on that subject here shortly. So to go back to the presentation, the PowerPoint, what we're going to be looking at next is me. As Oliver said, I've been involved in system science and future studies. I've taught at San Jose and at Antioch in Seattle. I've been a New Thought minister because as a futurist, I was discovering over and over again that the organization was only going to shift, or the community was only going to shift insofar as the individual did, and I needed to work on individual consciousness. And at the time, in the early 90s, it wasn't possible to do that. So I had to shift out of consulting into a more spiritual consciousness-oriented work. So I shifted. And back in as a futurist, I was working with Harman and Markley. What I do is I focus on the dynamics of consciousness and the dynamics of culture. That's how I've integrated all of this work together. And now I'm doing that through the Gaia Living Systems Institute and various IONS community groups. The thing that has happened for me in this project is that a long time ago, it seems like now it's coming up on 4 years, my goodness, I started having a series of meditations that were new to me. And I'm going to shift back to this other mode here. There we go. And these meditations were bringing me into a space I'd never had before. I've long used guided visualization and meditation as a tool for clarification, for relaxing, for all kinds of things. And one of the series of meditations that I've had over the years was to move into a state in which I experienced myself as being on a mountain, and there was a presence on that mountain, and that mountain, on that presence, was a person I identified as the Divine Mother, the Mother of all. And I would just be in that presence, and it was wonderful. It felt loving, it felt supportive. Sometimes I'd get clarity there. And over time, that presence shifted. She started out very distant, very classic, archetypal Divine Mother, and then over time she became warmer and she became more accessible, if you will. And one day in July of 2013, she invited me she said something to me, and she walked up to me and she put her arm around me and said, "Come walk with me." This is totally new. I never had any experience like this with her. And we're walking along the ledge of this mountain where I have met her for years and you know, been appreciative of her presence for years. We're walking along, and up ahead is a bank of clouds, a fog bank, if you will, just as you would normally find on a mountain. But as we got closer, I noticed that it sparkled. It sparkled, and it was shifting and changing. And she entered into the fog, and I watched her form dissolve into the fog. And then she had my hand in her hand, and my hand was starting to dissolve into that fog. And I experienced myself as becoming a fog cell, if you will. You know how clouds have billows? They're kind of like cells. Those billows turned out to be at different personalities, different beings, different entities. And I became one of them. And I got to hang out in this incredible environment of joy and delight and, you know, just sharing without words, without any sense of other than, oh, there is a presence I kind of recognize. And I would assign a face to that energy that I recognized. And some of those faces were people that I had worked with or I had admired from the past history. One of them was Buckminster Fuller. Another one was Albert Einstein. Another one, you know, was Edgar Mitchell. Another one, you know, there were all these men that had been doing these incredible work. And the Divine Mother was the essence of this cloud that they were playing in. And to give you a sense of the quality of their experience and my experience, at one point I was aware that they were emerging out of the cloud above it and then jump into form, like bodies, you know, the regular bodies, the bodies they had had in life, and then they would jump back into the cloud like cannonballs, you know, kids in a swimming pool jumping. And it was just great delight and fun. So I called this the bliss cloud. And it became one of my meditations to go into the bliss cloud and hang out with these beings who were in such joy and such delight. Well, to go back to the slide, that lasted for quite a while, and I shared it with Oliver, who is marvelous about these things. And then he held, in October 2015, a meeting of you guys. And in that meeting, I understood it, that Mona contacted him through someone else and told her about her list of white-haired men. And what I experienced was that some of those names were the same that had been in my cloud. And that's really all I thought about was, wow, that's interesting. There is an overlap there. What he shared with me was that these men, particularly Bucky Fuller, but what they wanted was that the world really begin to address the shortage of drinking water, the shortage of potable water. And I thought, yeah, that's really cool. And now they've asked Oliver to handle that. I wonder what he's going to do. So I went on with my life and ended up, you know, over the next few weeks, realizing that it was time to do a presentation. I was doing a series of presentations around the country at the time. And I was inspired to do one about water. And these are some of the slides that were part of that presentation. This is the work of a man named Schauberger in Vienna. And he found that when water moves through spirals, it hangs on to its molecular structure more effectively. It doesn't break up as much. And that was one of the pieces that I was working on in that presentation. I was already familiar with the water crystal work of Emoto, and I'm sure all of you are, but I wasn't familiar with these slides that the folks at the Institute for Aeronautics Research in Stuttgart, Germany, were developing. These are just dehydrated drops of water. And you can see they have different patterns. This one is researcher number one poured that water. Researcher number two poured that water, all from the same source. Researcher number three poured that water, and so on. So what we're seeing from the Stuttgart work, and they did a whole lot more work than this, is that the Emoto work that water remembers is visible through other means as well. And that helps us to understand, this is a photo of creating holy water from river water. And so one of the things I was doing in that presentation was showing us how we can take polluted, messed up water and restructure it into potable water. And would you believe I did not recognize that I was contributing to the work that Oliver had been told we needed to be doing until he told me so in February of that year, the next year. and so with that, I actually, for the first time, had the gumption to ask if anyone on the other side, anyone in the bliss cloud, had something to say. Now, I am not a channel. I have never been a channel. I have been able to do some healing work. I've been able to do quite a bit of recognition of spirit entities in a space and to facilitate spirit entities that needed to go home. That seemed to be part of my job in the world. If I went into a house, I lived in many, many houses over my life. I'm one of those people who's had as many addresses as birthdays. And sometimes there would be a presence in the house, and sometimes I would be called to recognize that presence and say, you know, you can go home. You don't have to stay here anymore. And so that would be part of my job. But the idea of reaching across to the other side and reaching any more information, you know, getting information from the other side was not part of my job, partly because of who I was in the New Thought ministry, and I'll talk about that in a bit. But because we had this conversation, and because I did go inside and connect with some of these guys, and we'll talk more about, well, at that particular one, it was Willis Harmon primarily, and Bucky Fuller, and Albert Einstein, and a couple of other folks that you wouldn't know, Dean Brown, and so on. But as a result of that conversation with Willis Harmon, I had an interesting experience about going to IONS. Now, I've been trying to get to the IONS offices for 10 years. As of April 2016, it was literally 10 years in Petaluma. I had used GPS, I had used people's instructions, I had used the map, I had used everything I knew, and every single time I had been blocked. I'd even gone to the visitor center and they informed me there was no Institute of Noetic Sciences in Petaluma. I mean, it was like, there was no way I was going to this place, right? But in April, I was there and I just, you know, I was working in Sonoma that day, and I took out my GPS and I said, that's where I want to go. And it took me to the freeway, and I was on a 101 freeway. I was heading south from Sonoma, and there was a big sign, and it said the exit that I needed, San Antonio Road, is closed. And I went, right, of course, I'm being blocked again, right? So I went, no, I'm not going to accept that this time. And I came around the corner, and there was the exit, and there was no barrier, no sign, no anything. I turned off the freeway. I turned onto San Antonio Road. I turned onto the Petaluma, or onto the IONS roadway, and I was there. And I knew in that moment this was my work. I was being told, yes, it was time. It was, you know, a way for me to connect. And so I did. Well, then Oliver sent me the clip that we just looked at the part of from the Helane presentation at IONS. And so I arranged with her. I had anticipated, having seen it, that I would be seeing her in Oregon, but it turned out I saw her at IONS in June and let her know that I'm happy to assist in any way with the project. We met again in August, and I became the coordinator of the literature review for the channeling project in August, and began to what Willis Harmon was saying through me, and not, it turns out not just through me, was that he wants to work directly with the staff at IONS. He wants them to be open to receiving the information that he has to offer from the other side. That was quite an amazing experience for me to sit there in the IONS office saying, he has something to say to you. Well, the response was, well, that we're hearing that from several sources, but we don't know how to access him. Who's going to channel him? And I said, well, he's standing right here. Do you want to hear from him? And I said, I'm happy to do what I can here. So I did. And he stood initially over on my right side, and he looked very much like he did in the painting, in that standing there. And he was quite jovial and quite fun. And he was saying, you know, we really need to do something different here. And I'm going to shift so that I can see you more fully, because it makes my life easier. There we go. Now I can see you better. So he was saying that we need to do something different in our hands. We need to be to shift how we are doing things away from the technology. And he was saying he really wanted to talk to the board. And he was also saying, ah, more people. Thank you. And if you, well, so, and he was also saying that he could, that he was concerned that the Institute was doing three things that needed to be done differently. One of them that he recommended was that the Institute start looking at the Silicon Valley engineering types, software types, people involved in Silicon Valley, for more of their board and advisory committee people. And the second thing that he said was that there was an audience out there who was ready for what IONS had to offer, but were not being reached through the IONS marketing and PR, and that is women like me. That is women who are in their middle years, who are more than reasonably educated, and who are aware that there is a lot more going on with regard to consciousness than the culture and the acknowledges. And he was saying we need to reach out to those groups. And then the third thing he said, and this is the one that hit me hardest really, was that the research needed to shift. It needed to be not so technology-based. It needed to, we needed to honor that it was an organic process. And more than that, he said, this was in August last year, so what, 5 months ago, he said, in a window of 15 to 30 months, the technology that you are using will no longer be usable. And that what replaces it will be so different that you won't be able to transfer from one to the other. So this is what he said to me, sitting in the IONS conference room with his portrait about 10 feet away. Well, along in, you know, as this was happening, as I say, he started out on my right side, and then she was saying she wanted more specifics, Helena in particular. So she, as I said, well, let's see what happens. So I experienced him moving around to my left side. And over here, he was this jovial 80-something-year-old. Over here, he was this 60-ish-something-year-old, and he was going, this is how it has to be. We need to do this and this and this and this. So I don't know how that's related to my structure or his structure or how the world works, but in terms of what we're looking at, you know, how does channeling work, it was a very interesting little detail. So that was Harmon's input in the IONS setting, and he is, you know, really wanting to talk to the board and to the staff and start to have them working more closely with them. All right, so if we go back to this timeline, that was the next piece, and then we started me working on the literature, okay? So I'm starting to do this work, and then to have me become the coordinator of the comprehensive review of the literature. Now, I sent out a letter to a number of people who were interested, and any of you who would like to join this are more than welcome. What we're going to be doing is looking at books and articles on the subject of the people who do the receiving. I forgot that it does that. Sorry about that. The people who do the receiving, how they do it, how they're affected by it, and what can be learned or taught to others about how they do it. We're not interested in the content of channeling. So this is the form that I invented to help us do that. You can hardly see it, and I apologize for that, but I don't have any way to make it bigger. You know, what you have is simply the name and the date of the review, the name of the reviewer and the date of the review, the book, the where it came from, the person that is being talked about, the channel that's being talked about, the kind of channel, remember that list we talked about, full trance, mental or whatever, when they started, how they learned, what the types of sources are, etc. So I just have things that people can circle. And then if they get into scientific papers, they also get to look at some of the theories. You know, is this about the absorption hypothesis, which is one of the frequent things that people talk about? Is this a spontaneous thing? Are there brain waves involved, brain scans, etc.? So those are the kinds of things that people use on the form. And then we've actually come up with some work. We have some results. This is how we're tabulating the results right now. Again, you can't really see that, but it's basically a spreadsheet that will become an Access database pretty soon. Now we're needing that point. We've got 331 total citations. 54 of them, only 54 documented experimental studies that we've been able to find for the last 25 years. So I'm going to have to go much further back in the history in these journals. We've got 35 that are reviews of the literature over the time. We've got 41 that are talking about what channeling ought to be or what it could be or, you know, whatever. And then 17 that are personal stories, like Jane Roberts talking about becoming Seth, or Ken Carey talking about how he came to do the series that he does. And the rest of the citations, you know, you can see we're only talking about a little over 100 here. The rest of them are things that I call baseline studies or tech guides. They are the baseline studies and tech guides are like, how do you do an EEG? How do you make you know, compare what a meditator is doing to what a channeler is doing and so on. So we've got a couple of hundred of those, and I think that's an important part of the research process is to be able to say, you know, we're using methods that other means of studies use, et cetera. So what are our results at this point? Our results are very limited. Well, gee, we just started. So we don't really have results yet beyond the fact that we actually have studies. What we do hope to accept and experience is this scientifically rigorous evaluation that bridges the gap between the materialist limitation that most scientists are still expecting us to live by and the psychic experience. But we also are hoping to bring it into mainstream visibility. We're trying to reduce the stigma and emotional distress. You know, many of us, you know, part of why I didn't do this, and many people have agreed with me, is that the people around us, you know, were saying, no, don't go there. I remember when I first started teaching intuitive methods in some of the church congregations I was working with, I'd have, you know, 70 and 80-year-old women raise their hands saying, I used to do that, but it got beaten out of me. So we're trying to reduce that in the culture, and we're also trying to reduce the likelihood of misdiagnosing. It turns out a lot of the characteristics of someone who is channeling are listed in the Diagnostic Statistical Manual as schizophrenic or psychotic behavior. So we want to stop having people be misdiagnosed. We're also involving as many people as possible. We've got 3,300 results so far in our initial survey, which I'll give you the link to at the end. And we're looking for more. We've got a list of 15,000 sample, random sample for our next survey that Helani is doing. And in the process, we're hoping to encourage social acceptance of this wonderful experience we call channeling. So let's talk about what I'm doing. As I said, this is not my norm. I've done a fair amount of Reiki. I've done a lot of work with intuition. Oliver and I started doing that in 75, and I had been working some with it before I met him, as he had long before he met me. The new thought healing processes, if you know people who are religious science practitioners or unity teachers, you know how we do that. And as I said, I help wandering spirits find their way home. And that bliss cloud experience did not include talk. It wasn't until Oliver asked that I was willing to do that. I call them the guys. The guys are in the background. If they have something to say, they're hesitating on the edge of my awareness. And that actually helped me to explain something to someone the other day that I don't have written. So I will tell you. What I've realized is that we have four ways of accessing, you know, abnormal information, okay? One of them is what we call intuition, our inner knowing, our deep inner knowing. The next kind of intuition is having access to knowledge that is outside of our own personal deeper inner knowing. Okay, so our deeper inner knowing, it comes from inside in some way. It doesn't feel like it's coming from outside. Then there is access to what I call the higher self. And the higher self feels like it's coming through me. All right? When I get up in front of a church on a Sunday morning, I'm sitting there and I'm saying, all right, I've prepared myself. I've studied this material. I'm on top of this material. And I'm ready to have the higher self, the Holy Spirit, speak through me so that everyone in the room can understand it. I'm not always aware of what I'm saying when I'm doing that. It's not always me. And that's ideally, I've gotten out of the way completely. That's through me. But what's happening in this situation, when Edgar or Willis or Wink or Dean Brown or any of these other guys show up, is that they're speaking to me. They're speaking to me from outside of me, just as you would be if we were in the room together. And so I'm what they call a mental channel. I'm not an embodied channel in that respect. I don't go into trance. I am fully aware of what's going on. And that has been a way that I can make those distinctions. People were asking me that. So when you're aware of someone on the periphery of one's awareness, okay, they're never right in front of us, for me anyway, and they haven't been for anyone I've been able to talk to. They're on the periphery of awareness. You focus your awareness on the periphery, and then you allow the information to come to you. And that's the way that I have found to make that distinction. I hope that's useful. So what I do generally is I sit in a comfortable position, and I usually have my laptop keyboard open, and I type whatever comes through. I'm able to type fast enough that I can get away with that. I have other friends who do automatic writing. So I thought I'd share with you something that I typed. I will expand this again. Okay, Oliver and I had been talking on the phone, and then I checked in again to see if Edgar had anything more to say. This is the evening that Oliver's talking about, when Edgar said and actually did. So now he's talking to me, and he says, it really is a good thing to start including this form of information exchange in the IONS process, an obvious next step in our work. I'm pleased that Helani is on board and look forward to seeing, helping this project as it moves forward. I know that Willis spoke through you the other day. This is the one that I mentioned earlier when I was sitting in the IONS office. And I'm aware of his concern about the hardware focus. It's as much philosophical as practical. We need to acknowledge that these are inherent abilities in biological organisms, and to be working from a biological-psychological model more and more. We also need to recognize that the emerging technologies will immediately supplant anything we've been using, rendering them obsolete almost before we can see them coming. His time frame is a little fuzzy, because he always hedges his bets, as you know. So that was the first piece of what he was saying to me, that he wants us to recognize that this work is important. It's a logical thing for IONS to be doing, and he also is recognizing and confirming what Willis Harmon had told me in the office. But I was particularly impressed that he refers to it's inherent in biological organisms. He doesn't say human beings. And this totally supports the work that Rupert Sheldrake is doing, where he's talking about the dogs and the cats and other critters who are aware before people even get in the car that they're coming home. That he's run clocks in the office and in the house. And at the very instant that the person at the office closes up and picks up their keys, the dog wakes up and starts getting ready for the owner to come home, for the person to come home, the other part of the pack. So, there is that awareness. It's an inherent ability. And we've seen evidence of both, in the body and discarnate kind of communications going on in our four-legged friends, as well as our two-legged friend. And I will bring up the next slide as we continue this conversation. For IONS, this is a logical progression in the work. For you, me personally, Ruth, this is the hierarchical restructuring you've been waiting for. The reorganization of your mental and emotional processing to allow you to function at a level more in alignment with your capabilities. This means you need to recognize the blocks in you and release them as they come up, not a week or two later. You need, for yourself and for this work, to open the flow across brain field segments, but more, across aspects of self and source that you have felt as other in the past, whether insects or ETs. So, what's that about? I grew up in a world where my family was art historians and my mother was a defense analyst. My grandmother had worked for Gandhi and my mother worked for the Defense Department. It was a very interesting world. And I learned very early on to separate this world from that world. So then I'm a woman. I'm a woman in our culture. And so, you know, whatever I do as a mom, a wife and mom, can't be brought into the workplace. So I learned to separate. So I have all these little barriers in my being. And what I discovered was academia wasn't interested in the sexual stuff or the psychic stuff. So that's over there. So for 20 years of my life, I did academia over here, wife and mother over here, spiritual over here, and never the three shall meet, right? Then when the body gave out, it was in part because of that. The energy of maintaining those barriers was part of the cost of that led to the body giving out. When I began to heal the body, it was through the methods that are known as religious science and unity and new thought and meditation and all that good stuff. And I, you know, was able to heal the body when medical science wasn't able to give me any support for that. So we heal the body, heal the mind, heal the spirit. And as I continue in that work, I began to be aware there is no way that I could continue to do consulting and academic work. I had to do the spiritual work. So I ended up in the ministry, which was not ever something I thought was possible, much less part of my life. So I did that for the next 20 years. But I couldn't bring the academic stuff into the ministry because, well, who wants to hear about cybernetics and quantum physics when you're talking about spirituality, right? So, you know, now about... Some years ago, I realized, oh good, actually with the shift of 2012, I realized I needed to stop being a full-time minister, and I needed to go back, and I needed to integrate the spiritual work and the academic work. And that was cool, and that's what I've been doing up in, you know, for the last 5 years. However, what happened through this process is there was another barrier. It was called the psychic stuff. The psychic stuff was not something you did as a minister, right? You don't talk about ghosts. You don't talk about discarnate beings. You talk about the Holy Spirit, you know, right? So I had to bring that in now. So now that I am only part-time minister and mostly in Unitarian environments, so I have a little more flexibility, I'm able to integrate all three, the academic, the spiritual, and the psychic. But there is more here because, as you may have heard, Edgar Mitchell said I needed to break down my sense of other, even with insects and ETs, right? And I have to say, every time I've had an ET experience, actually I just had one yesterday, and it almost always feels insectoid. Now, if you ever saw, if you saw an Ender's Game, or, and you know, any of those, that often the ETs that are portrayed are very much like insects, and they have a hive mentality. And my very first experience of that was in doing a mind games exercise, so Robert, Gene Houston, Robert Masters' book, Mind Games, and I found myself on a planet where everyone was living in hives, in these little huts, and I thought they were huts, but then I discovered they were hives, and I was physically disgusted. I had to pull out of it. I couldn't handle it. And so over time, I've been able to accept that more and more. Well, about a week after I got this reading, no, it wasn't a week, sorry, it would have to be about a month after Edgar said these words to me, I was reaching across a queen-size bed, stretched across the bed, and all of a sudden, my body was the body of a fly. I could feel the shell. I could feel how the eyes were different. I could feel the wings. I could feel how the legs and arms were different. I could feel being an insect. There was no longer separation between this body and that kind of a body. It was the most amazing experience, and it lasted 2 minutes, you know, hardly anything longer than that, but I'm not likely to forget it. And I think it was them, Edgar in particular, all of the guys helping me to break through these barriers, as he suggested. Now, he used the term hierarchical restructuring. My very first published paper was on hierarchical restructuring as the mechanism by which social and community systems change. And so, you know, he was suggesting that it doesn't have to be out in the world, it's also going on in here, and that that's the process I'm going through. So, I've been talking for an hour here, and I hope that I've given you something useful. He did say another thing, and I'd like to share that with you, and then perhaps we can go to the next stage in this process, okay? This last paragraph. We who have been occupying your bliss cloud, remember my bliss cloud, that's how I've, you know, contacted these guys, are simply the aspects of mind, the one mind, that you resonate with. We are all operating dealing with the same issues, personal and global, and coming to the same understandings. You are one of us, but you are also in your very alive woman's body, which none of us are, nor remember ever being. That's why the essence of the mother brought you into awareness of our current experience, that you may know the degree to which you are part of it and share it. So what I'd like to do now is share it. He's not just telling me, he's telling all of us. One of the things that I've learned over the years as I've studied, you know, consciousness and studied resonance is we're not ever in the same place at the same time unless we are resonating. And although we are not physically, I'm not physically in Austin, we are all in the same place at the same time addressing the same stuff.
Do you want to do a couple of questions before you do the channeling?
If someone has anything about what I've said, I'm happy to respond.
I have a question in regards to the data.
No?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So I have a question regarding the data that you're collecting in the experiment. Are you going to be doing some sort of statistical analysis on all? It's like a data.
The material that I'm collecting, I'm going to, you know, at the very least, see if there are any correspondences. I mean, we are finding that there are three or four groups working together in Brazil, a little bit in Great Britain, not much, a little bit in Australia, not much, a little bit in the U.S., not much. So if I can find anything to compare, I will. At this point, it's just collecting it. Thank you.
Any questions?
Any others?
Okay.
All right. Wow, that's a nice group of folks. Okay, so the whole time I've been talking, Edgar's been hanging out over here. Yeah, Edgar's been hanging out over here, and Harmon's kind of behind him, and there's someone over here that Markley knows, but I don't know if anyone else knows about him. We call him Wink. He was a development director for IONS under the, when Harmon and Mitchell were working together. So, yeah, when Oliver first said he would like to to have Edgar talk to this group, he indicated his willingness, and he's actually been hanging out ever since. So I have no idea what it is that he has in mind to tell us. So I'm just going to, I'm going to ask him. I'm going to invite him in, and say, what is it that you have to tell us? It's very strange. I'm not typing. So this is going to be recorded. Oh, you need to do something different? You okay? All right. So he is, he's actually been standing in your room. That's part of why you were leaning over that direction. He's standing in your room to the, what I would experience if I was sitting in your spot as the left side of the computer. He's telling me to tell you, and he's actually telling you, but it has to be through me, that he really, really appreciates that you're willing to come together and continue this work in your own lives and in support of ION. He knows that you have to give up something else to do this, and he really gets that, and he really honors that. And he hopes that you understand that whatever you gave up will be, will be more than paid for by what happens here. He wants you to know that you don't have to be afraid, even though it looks as if a lot of things are falling apart. They have to fall apart in order to come back together again, but to the extent that you remain in community, working together, sharing with each other, supporting each other with each other's gifts, because you all have different gifts. And he's saying there's an engineer in the room who's going to be very helpful when the technology begins to give out. And there's a person in the room who cooks really well and knows how to cook without electronics, and that's going to be a really important person. And that kind of thing. He's saying, do that for each other. Be open to that for each other, because there's going to be times when it looks as if everything is falling apart. But it isn't going to last very long. And the extent to which we understand that we share the consciousness is the extent to which it can happen more smoothly and easily. So what he'd like you to do is be aware that there is someone in your life right now who is trying to reach you, not someone on the other side, someone on the planet right now who is trying to send you love. See if you can be aware of that in this moment. It's not just in this room, but in your life, in the world, on this planet. He's saying those connections are the most important connections. And we need to learn to become aware of that. He said the technology is useful, but as he said in that little, it's not sufficient. This is something we all need to be opening to and all need to be aware of. And the technology sometimes keeps us from doing that. All right, he's telling me to tell you some of the things they've had me do. I am now collecting as much information as I can on nanotubes, carbon nanotubes, and graphene, and quantum computing. And what it looks like is going to happen is the next stage of data collection and manipulation, et cetera, is going to be looking more like an organism than like a machine because of the use of graphene and nanotubes. We're going to be seeing more and more apparently psychic sharing. The internet will be more and more telepathic and clairvoyant in our experience. It will be just as solid as it has been in the wires, but it will look organic and telepathic for more and more people. He's saying that, and this is the other piece that they've asked me to focus on, saying we need to think more and more in terms of small communities, 20 to 200 households. And he's got me collecting a lot of data and putting it on a website so that people will have access to how to do that. And that each of these communities, even if they're originally in an urban environment, each of these communities will have a community center where whatever technology is needed will be, you know, available and present and supported. And he's knowing that there are going to be two or three of you people who are helping to make that happen for the communities you're part of. And that the network that is the IONS group is the network of those communities. And that's why he's hoping you will continue to work together. So you aren't living together in a single community. You're living in multiple communities. And he's trusting that the IONS network, the IONS community group, will be a way for those physical, geographical communities can work together and communicate and be mutually supportive. Is that clear? Does that make sense? Is it coming through? Good. All right. So, someone in the room is asking about his astronaut experience. And so he's saying, yes, it was a very powerful experience. And yes, he would do it over it again in a heartbeat. And yes, there were all kinds of strange things that he didn't feel like he could talk about at the time. Some of them, yes, sir. the ones that he talks about most frequently are the remote viewing and the telepathic communications he experienced. He had set those up ahead of time, little experiments, but the ones that he didn't talk about until the end of his life were when he was made very much aware that there are what we call ETs in the world, in the universe, and they are visiting the planet now. He's had a number of communications with what we would call ETs, and they're all very hopeful, very, very hopeful. He is aware that our tendency is to focus on the beings who represent the qualities of tearing apart, taking apart. But we need to recognize that those are a very, very, very small portion of the collective consciousness forms that are out there all around us. And some of them are operating on more like 7 or 8 dimensions rather than 3 or 4. We tend to operate on 3 or 4. Some of them are operating on the 4 to 5. They're operating on time, just outside our time and space. And some of them are actually shifting through multiple universes. They see multiple universes as their home. They don't even think about any single universe as home. So as we evolve and become more aware of who we truly are, we will be able to be connecting with them. He said he only experienced them in spurts when his own consciousness was expanded to the point where he could take it in, and that suddenly it would not happen, and he wouldn't see them, and he'd be frustrated. And we may be having some of those same experiences as things happen in the future. The more on the space thing, there are some people that are wondering what's on the other side of the moon. And there is something going on the other side of the moon, but not everyone will be aware of it. Some people will not see it. Just, you know, and that's part of why I put that quote from Harmon in there. People will discount. They won't even see what does not fit their belief framework. Okay? So again, only when they were, you know, whoever was looking at the other side of the moon, was able to be in that consciousness, that belief system that allowed the possibility of it, they could detect what was really happening. The rest of the time, their minds would literally convert this white sparkly thing into just a shiny, you know, a bit of sunshine off a rock. So that's what minds do. All right. The agenda for IONS is the other thing that's coming up. He says, from his perspective, IONS is just beginning to enter into what it could be. They started by finding reasonable studies and encouraging them and, you know, letting people know about them, then starting to do their own studies, and that's been the last, you know, 20 years or so. He says the next stage is to actually be a force on the planet for people knowing, understanding, and living with this deeper, more expansive understanding of what consciousness is. And that's what he has to say. So, again, great gratitude and thanks and appreciation that you're willing to do this. He hopes that you will take this into your lives and that you will be an effective member of your individual communities and the IONS community, especially over the next 2 to 3 years. This is the bridge time. This is the time when we need to hold it and keep moving forward. And the image that I just got in my head is from Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. He's in the cave. His father's notes say he has to take a step in faith, and he steps out into a chasm, and lo and behold, what looked like vertical rock is a bridge. Yeah? It's the same kind of a thing. That's what he's giving us. So thank you. All right. Willis is still standing there behind him. So let's see what Willis Harmon has to say today. Okay. He's laughing at Mark. Harmon and I knew Oliver Markley as Mark. And so, you know, he's laughing at him and saying, yeah, this is a good step. This is a good one. Thanks. And he's saying, and I'm hoping you'll get some engineers to work on that water project, too. For the group, some of you have been with us a very long time, he says. He recognizes people who have been on the roles of the community group or membership for more than a few weeks or months or even years. And he really, really appreciates that you stuck with your support of IONS. Those of you who have been with us for a long time will recognize that we went into a quieter phase for a while. And then we were seeking, as an organization, what our new role is. You may be aware of our work with the shift and, you know, how we took kind of a background work role in that organizational process. Mostly that was, he says, so that Dean Radin could collect the data he needed to publish the books that he's publishing. He's about to come out with a new one. His last one, Supernormal, was exactly what we needed to do to wake the scientific community up. All right. He's given me permission to share with you my perceptions. As I say, I knew Willis Harmon when my mother worked for him. I was a teenager when my mother worked for him. And she shared with me a little bit about his background in engineering. And he was interested in her interest. My mother collected science fiction from 1939 to 1989. So she was very much on top of that body of literature. And he was interested in what she could contribute to the educational policy research from the realm of science fiction so that we could begin to wake students up to the possibility of the future using the fiction, which is very interesting because in my 30s, in my graduate work, that became part of what I was about, was how can we wake people up to new understandings of the future through the use of fiction. And in fact, in my dissertation, we talked about that quite a bit. And that was the article that got published last year in one of those journals that Oliver helped put together. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So I understood Willis's experience being from the engineering perspective. He was at Pearl Harbor in the Navy, and he went through engineering school, and he taught engineering at Florida, and then he went to Stanford and he taught engineering. And we came up into the 60s, and, well, Timothy Leary was a very popular character and offering a lot of interesting things. And my observations were that Willis managed to experience, through the use of the kinds of mind-altering substances and opportunities that were, you know, provided during the early 60s, he did the shift that a lot of engineers do when they can have that experience, and woke up to humanity, woke up to the interaction of science with the mind and the heart. And so he moved from strictly engineering into teaching a class called Human Potential. He did a very strange thing at the time. He actually offered some of his classes in his home, and out of that became concerned about how society was moving forward, whether it was possible to embody the human potential in our culture. So that led to a number of things. And the point at which I came into the picture, my mother had left SRI in 74, and I came in 75, and that was just as you were completing Oliver and Mark and Willis and Dwayne Elgin and Arnold Mitchell and a few others, the Changing Images of Man study. And that was really the platform, I think, for the next 20, 30 years' work. This was a study that included Margaret Mead and Joseph Campbell and Arthur Hastings and some wonderful minds to help people understand that how we were relating to the earth, how we were relating to ourselves, how we were relating to spirit was defining what was going to happen to humanity. And if we didn't change that fundamental relationship, we weren't going to be able to survive as a species, much less as a culture. So that, you know, how do we change it? That became the baseline. And in many ways, it's been a baseline for my work, and I think it's continued to be part of Oliver's work as well. So that's what Willis just gave me permission to share with you my experience. Now I'll let him talk again. So he says global mind change was the obvious next step after the Changing Images work. And global mind change then became the basis and the platform what IONS was about. How do we, what is it, and what is the global mind, and. So he's kind of chuckling now because he realizes that the work, when I stepped out of academia into the ministry, I stepped into a form of ministry that talks about one mind. We are one mind, and everyone, every thought that we are really thinking, not just the tapes we play over and over again, but our true thoughts are thoughts of the one mind. And he's referring back to another level that I talk about a lot, and that's Ralph Waldo Emerson, who said there is one mind common to all humanity. This is the beginning of his history essay, his essay on history. One mind common to all humanity, and each of us is an inlet, an outlet, to the same. All history is biography. All biography is history. Powerful, powerful concept. And the whole essay is history addresses that and unfolds that idea. So Willis is saying, is, you know, chuckling about the fact that I'm off on my own doing this while he's off on his own doing that. We actually had an interaction back in the 80s. Where I was realizing that the sciences had moved from the hard sciences through the life sciences into the social sciences, and now we were moving into the noetic sciences. And, you know, he wrote a little article about that, and it was wonderful that he did. And what he's asking all of us to do now is to recognize that we've been trained in those first three sciences, but we haven't been trained in this fourth one. And perhaps we are defining this fourth one now. So he's inviting you, as you have thoughts about how the science of the noetics might be unfolding, that you write letters to the journal, that you write letters to the institute, that you send emails, that you send programs like this, whatever, that would facilitate their continuing to define this new science of the noetics. And that's all he has to say today. All right, Wink is in the background. I told you that Wink is a development director, and he's the one who's got me doing these things, these presentations. It's all his fault. Anyway, he's also appreciative that you're here, and very grateful to you, and particularly grateful for all the ways you support IONS and what this work is about. And he's a bit of a jokester, and he's standing here with a grin on his face, and he's saying, okay, now you all get to go out and create new opportunities for more people to have this kind of information. So he's inviting you, please, go out. You know, invite people into your homes, invite people to get together, create, you know, mini sub-IONS community groups, whatever you need to do. Call your friends, call your family, let people know this is happening. Do it. There we go. So that's what I have to say. I think, Bucket Fuller does have something he wants to add. There is someone in that room, and I think it's the man in the black t-shirt behind Oliver, who has an idea for a technology, and he would love it if that man would sit down and put that into some kind of framework that we could share. Please. All right. That's it. I'm going to switch the mic back on for you guys so you can respond.
Good. So all of these men you're in touch with, and it's wonderful, the heroes of the noetic science movement, are you in touch with any women out there?
Oh, you know, I've had that question. It's the question in my mind. Why are they all guys? What I've been told is that the resonance of being active and doing something in the world is a masculine kind of resonance, and that the women who were doing things in the world have gone on to other things. So these guys are still wanting to make things happen in the world, but the women have gone on elsewhere and they're doing other things. The Divine Mother is holding the framework whereby these are interacting. And when they're formless, they're in the bliss cloud. They begin to take on form as soon as they have a thought. They take on their astral form. And they have a space that they've created that looks like a project design room, like whiteboards and flip charts and all of that around it. And they get in there and they play and they talk and they drink coffee and they do all the things they used to do when they were in their material body. And then, you know, one of them begins to dissolve back into the cloud. And another one comes back into the astral form, and they go back and forth. But apparently the women who have done this work are in another realm and are not playing this game.
Does that have any implications for us here?
Oh, interesting. Yes, they're supporting. Many of you have heard that the Dalai Lama has said that if the world is going to survive, it'll be because Western women have stepped into leadership. And the women on the other side are supporting those women being strong in that. Because I grew up in a world where engineering and spirituality were equal, I get to resonate back and forth. But if I had not had that experience, I would probably be doing something else entirely. That makes sense? Thanks. Others?
Other questions? Comments?
Thank you, Ruth. You're wonderful.
Thank you.
I'm going to go closer and see you.
You mentioned that there was a cook in the room. Will it be important to learn how to cook without technology?
Oh, marvelous. Each of us is going to have the experience that our own belief systems bring forth. That's what my ministry work is about, is to help us get in touch with what our belief systems are so we can understand the experiences we're having. So some of us are kind of earth mothers, and we will show up in a way that will be mothering and nurturing to people who are ready for and needing that support as things shift and change. Some of us won't experience hardly any shift at all. It'll be like, yeah, we'll go without something for a day or two, but we won't even know. It's kind of like the power's out, right? Some of us will experience horrendous breakdowns in order to have the breakthrough we need, because we've not been unwilling to let go of our attachments to things being a certain way. So what each of us needs to do is be clear about what we would ideally experience this world as. What does the highest and best possible human experience on planet Earth look like? And let go of anything in us individually that would prevent that, so that we can make a smooth transition toward it. Thank you. That was a good question. Was there anything else, Oliver, you wanted to make sure was covered?
Well, I'm really intrigued by what you said. There is a grouping of this, this place where they meet and hang out and do projects, things. I'm currently reading the book by Rosalind McCormick about her soul guides in the afterlife. She worked with Robert Monroe, wrote the book Cosmic Journeys, and now this book Soul Journeys. And she talks about how Robert Monroe has an equivalent to the Monroe Institute up there and is wanting to channel things through to here. So I guess I'd like to hear from any of them what they want to say about the promise and prospect of us doing more organized things to bring through wisdom from the other side and have a interdimensional.
All right. So they have instructed me with your input. He is such an instigator, you guys, as if you didn't know that already. what they've instructed me to do is create a website that, using Oliver's language, the Interdimensional Institute for Advanced Sciences, and it was originally the Transdimensional Institute for Advanced Sciences, and so the website initially got created as TDIS, but is accessible as IDIAS. It's accessible either way, .org. And it's a site for them to share with me, through me, through anyone who wants to contact us and be part of it, information for people to have to be able to create the emerging culture, to be able to create life on the other side of the kinds of technological solutions we're used to, with different kinds of technologies based on an organic, organismic, and spiritual consciousness kind of way of living in harmony with the planet. So that's part of why Gaia Living Systems is involved in this, right? Because that's what we're about, too. So the combination, for me personally, I have the various church organizations I'm involved in, whether they're New Thought or Unitarian. I have the Gaia Living Systems Institute, and I have IDIAS as ways to all triangulate on what is emerging as a possible way of being. Yes, in the back. Thank you. Okay, I didn't hear all of that except the word, how can virtual? So I'm going to guess, how does virtual reality help us?
How can virtual reality help us to advance?
All right. So when we're involved with virtual reality, what we are doing is trying on experience. And we will be in the future trying on and then experiencing in more and more physicality. Okay? So the virtual reality technologies are actually expanding consciousness in some weird way by letting us know that what the body-mind thinks it's experiencing isn't necessarily what it's actually experiencing, right? And, you know, my children made sure that I got to see as much of the Matrix as I could stand to see, because this body-mind does not handle adrenaline well. So, but the main reason they did was for that purpose, so that I could see that this concept that what the body-mind is experiencing is not necessarily what's happening. Could be, you know, the fact that it is being made real to so many people. So the virtual reality is helping that. The other piece is that with virtual reality, we have actually extended the capacity of a process that Oliver and I worked on back in the 70s, and that was to visualize an ideal future. Now, we're going to modify the virtual reality programs in order to do that, because they're not doing that right now. We need to work on the software for virtual reality programs so that they allow us to visualize the ideal future, to allow us to experience through the virtual reality experience those visualizations. Because what we can experience in concept, we can experience in physical. And that actually brings up a concern, because most people are experiencing in concept a really nasty world. You know, CSI and all of that stuff. You know, what we need to do is begin to spend more of our time experiencing the world we wish to be experiencing. I hope that helps. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for bringing that up. That's an area I want to explore.
Any other last questions before we wind up? I have kind of a little bit of a technical question.
Okay.
When you're dealing with channeling, is that different from mediumship?
Good. I hope not. However, a medium, there's so many ranges of mediums, but yeah, it may be that mediumship and channeling are the same thing, or that there is a range of mediums that are outside of the range of channeling, or vice versa. We don't know exactly, okay? But we do know that we're talking about people who are accessing information from discarnate beings and then sharing it, whatever that looks like. And, you know, the Long Island medium, yep, she's one, right? Sylvia Brown was one, yeah. I was fortunate. I got to see Sylvia Brown in one of her very last presentations, public presentations. She came here to Oregon. She was on the coast. I wasn't planning to see her, had no intentions of, but one of the elders of the local tribe walked up to my door the day that this was happening and said, "I have a ticket. You're coming with me." Isn't that intriguing? I had never seen her outside of very brief things on TV. And I sat there and I watched her, and I realized that what she was doing was something that is so accessible to all of us. I mean, it was so clear that what she was doing was not something that was beyond everyone else in that room. And I think some of the people actually heard that. I hope so. Thank you. Oh, good. I get to see that side of the room. What, Oliver?
As a last statement before we wind up, I just share that one of the profound things that's coming to me out of all these interactions with you and the things that have been happening is that what you're describing is more a thing of being rather than of doing and getting. Like you say about the bliss count of being there and doing that. And that's what I heard you basically saying, being.
Thank you.
Well, I'd like to thanking Ruth and saying that if you want to check into her website, it's www.ruthlmiller, ruthmiller.phd.com. www.ruthmillerphd.com.
We're going to have a good extended discussion afterwards. We do that, and it'll be very deep, and I think you may get some questions sent to you by your email address is?
Well, you can get it on the site, but it's ruth@ruthmillerphd.com.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
If you'd like to be part of this project, here's some of the ways you can contribute. And if you'd like to be part of the survey, helping us understand who's got the gift and where it came from, here's the link. And I'd like to thank you for being part of this presentation. I hope you enjoyed it.